for the weekend, working up the courage. Oh, and we pray away, pray away, pray away the pain of not being in alignment with our dreams. Fetch your life, go on, be alive. Ain't nobody living out here, be someone who's living out here. Fetch your life, go on, be alive. Ain't nobody living out here, be someone who's living out.
House of Sankofa, of course, the place where we devil in music, spiritual, cultural things. We're back once again, Msaki Mvula, alongside Usibusiso. And today we have a young lady who's done, in a short period of time, so much work within music. And of course, you know, from where I started noticing her, she came across, you know, as a beautiful vocalist who plays the guitar as well. But I'll tell you what, you know, her trajectory in ascending in this musical scope has just been something to marvel at as I watch her progression. Ladies and gentlemen, award-winning Msaki. How are you?
I'm great. Nandi Kelele Award because it's very new.
It's very new.
Yeah,
and congratulations.
Thank you.
How did that make you feel?
It made me feel like it's the very beginning. That's what it made me feel like. I was like, yo, if it also gave me like a pat on the back. I know the summers or whatever all of these award spaces are highly emotive, bringing out different sides of us. But for me, it felt like a pat on the back from my peers and from people that have been on the receiving end of my music, but have given back to me in the way that they give me feedback about how things have made them feel, what they've taken them out of. So yeah, like that, I felt that the wave of support coming back to me through a tiny little gold statue thing.
That's a beautiful
isn't
thing.
Isn't that strange? And I took it like that. I was like, this is what I'm going to take this as a pat on the back and head down, carry on. We've got like a lot more songs to catch.
You know? Let me just go back in my own mind. I mean, I stumbled upon you. It must have been 2013, 2014 or so. And you've always honored, you know, our invitations, you know, from the days at Power FM, coming through to Vision View as well. At the time, I think you were just making your way up, you know. You always like to say, just bask and sing a little bit, you know, here and there. But we could clearly see that, you know, there's more to this talent than anything else. And then Zanelisa dropped the album, which I just fell in love with. Famaziyabona was just something special for me. Because I could just see in the writing what you were trying to put across. Take us back to your humble beginnings in musicality. And, you know,
So my story is one of going against the grain or the flow, I think, of my life, trying to be something that I thought was important. I made a choice, not with a lot of pressure from home, to be an attorney after school. My dad happened to be an attorney. This is why I'm saying the pressure was not from my parents.
Yeah.
But I was like, I did well at school. My results are good. I can go down the science route, but if I go here, maybe it'll give me a chance to read. Maybe I can do philosophy. I can do a BA. I can do something where I can start nourishing my creative spirit, you know? Like, this is maybe my subconscious talking. I'm not having that kind of chat with myself as a grade 12 student. I was like, you know, Rhodes, maybe to go study journalism. I enjoyed English at school. I always had a good relationship with teachers that valued words. And one of them was an English teacher. Omnia was actually my biology teacher. And the thing that we were smuggling between each other were books. So
I see.
I think from a young age, I've enjoyed words and I've understood poetry from a deep place, mostly as a fan
of poetry.
I was a very hyperactive child, but put me in front of a book or a creative, you know, rabbit hole. When that side of my brain was working. And other sides, I would need to be moving. I always needed to be moving. So you can imagine.
Yes.
The new sense, a class in, and clearly still, you know, I'm always looking out the window. I'm always processing something. So I think as a kid, the beginning of the love of music or that artistry or that path started with poetry.
For sure. I've never really asked you this question. Anyone in the family been musically orientated?
Did Definitely. It comes through in my story because I write a song that my grandfather started. Choral composer, Sibenza Montfrey as a teacher, perpetually starting choirs. All of my dad and his brothers were in a choir that my grandfather led. And I also have information like from the South African Bantu black composers.
Right, you know? Right.
Found a book, found some of his work at the SABC archives with the help of my dad. And he was a prolific composer. I started tracing some of his songs, trying to find school kids that could have gone past.
Yes.
I was also on this mission with my dad. It made us very happy to be searching for my grandfather's songs. To
it
find out that this
family.
Man has got 120 compositions. Abanye bathi, hi, ezinye sava zafa no sisipindi. Oh, kanye nisifunde. You know? So we were looking for these songs and we met one of his contemporaries, Utatu Bashe. And my gut was just like, da-da-da-da-da, they was busy. You know, we can't. Tatu Bashe was sick.
Okay.
And we visited him. He gave us maybe another 100 songs or another 80 songs that my dad and his brothers didn't know because they were always in competition against each other. Tatu Bashe was a composer from another school, but they were friends. So they had this rivalry. This is Nadal,
Federer,
Roger Federer,
Nadal type of rivalry. Yeah.
But you know the how people learn your songs is that if a choir sings it well at a competition, kubekwe imali ifuna iphindwe. So you could have good compositions in a bad choir and people don't want to hear the song again.
Right.
You know? So they're also trying to pick the all stars and they've got this like, dipikong tatu bad, when you have all saying, you know.
So all this music was charted.
Some of it was charted.
Yes.
Some of it was just recorded in this way.
And
people learn new songs. Everything was passed on. Just you know. Oral audio.
Beautiful.
Yeah, beautiful train line. So my dad, my grandfather's a composer. My father, you know, I think it's just because of the time. My dad got a job at 17 as a clerk so that he could raise enough money to go to varsity. He had other siblings. By then, my grandfather had passed away. And you have to still send my mark or somewhere. You know, Elaline, you've got to think about how to move forward. So he took this job as a clerk, sent himself to the University of Forte. Got his law degree. And then had to work as a teacher because you're not going to, it's also expensive to become a lawyer, you know, after you've become a lawyer in terms of time, you know, and what you, so anyway, he went and started teaching. And then he was also a person who just perpetually started choirs. I'm sure he converted a soccer team into a choir at some point.
Was this in the Eastern Cape?
It's in the Eastern Cape. So he started teaching, he moved, ended up, his teaching took him to the petty side of the world, petty, and he settled there with my mom. He ran a school called Mahele Dane. They were both principal and deputy. And the choir was always winning all the trophies. And the kids were neat. And my parents were the parents of a village, you know. So music was part of that, you know, as well. On my mother's side, there's a beautiful singing tradition. They're from the Alice Etigen, Epeulen side. Onuka, Nungukan.
Okay.
People saying there's a big pastoral gift there.
Yes.
So lots of pastors, lots of otandazeli. A lot of people that are just like that white cloth spirit inclined.
Yes.
I think some of it rests on me. I have some inclinations. I'm not sure. On my dad's side, I know that there's also like a spiritual healer, like more rosy type of spirit.
Spirit, yeah.
But the music just being passed down. Composers that are interested in song, composers that are asked by leaders, you know, about, hey, sinendwe, arriving. Please write a welcome song, you know?
Yes.
So even when I was a kid, I was always asked to write like birthday songs for friends, like customized songs that would go straight to someone's heart. And I didn't, and I thought it was a joke because I was like, I have a sense of humor. I'll write a song if I need to tease someone or I'll write that song that will make them feel what their family or their friends or their besties want them to feel. And I didn't realize that I was being trained for something.
Wow.
As well. So that was kind of passed on.
So you feel it was systematic now that you're grown up and you can look back.
In retrospect, definitely.
Right?
Yeah, nothing was a misstep at all. Yeah.
How beautiful is that?
It's amazing.
I mean, she very rarely talks about, you know, this sort of experience, especially from, you know, your family background. And it's amazing, you know, to find out that you come from such a rich musical family, both maternal and paternal, and that's what's groomed you to be this powerhouse that you know you're becoming.
Thank you. No, I think there's something to be said about, you know, that being a gift that is also cultivated, but one that can just live in the blood. Because I think about, as a Ngugana, my family splits into Ngugana because of a marriage. It's a long story, but we have the Nuganas are also our family. Mm. When they've got something on, see a kwala pezonuka. And there's so many musicians there. The Nugana family is all like they're the jazz heads of the Eastern Cape. Mm. And all the generation of Itandon. But there's something in the Eastern Cape about this music, you know. And even like just the way that there are so many vocalists, there's so many beautiful storytellers.
It's amazing.
So I'm not just saying that it's a family thing, but I'm saying that the space that we come from, the same way that in my mother's village, they would have excellent cricket players because they're close to a mission. And the diligence and the Saturdays would be spent doing that. There's something that an area also gives you. And I think that area, say Ali's Digeni, it was cultivated, the love of music, which is why so many families had these instruments floating around, thinking that it's an important thing to pass on, you know? So I do think there is a location element outside of my family.
That, and now we have a venue in Saint in Etikane. It's beautiful space.
Etikane, yes. Alice Lane.
Yes.
I love it. So smart.
Any of the parents pick up an instrument or use maybe a piano for reference, you know, in writing songs and things like that?
No, it was all just natural.
Vocal.
My dad's a left-handed. He's left-handed, but he can play my guitar upside down. So it's... He would need a special left-handed guitar, and he'd grow up without
Hendrix.
One. But yeah, so you can see there's a lot of, even if this had talent, this raw talent had been taken further and groomed, you know. He's politically, you know, like just having to think about the kind of lives and the kind of choices that you make.
Yes.
You're going to be thinking about your passion lost.
Mm.
And I do sometimes have my heart gets sore about what about my dad's unexpressed passion and gift, you know. And I feel like it figure like tenfold now because the previous generation was denied, you know, a freedom to. And now this is why, you know, songs like Fetch Your Life come from there. But like, we are so close to, just because of the time and era we're in and the fact that we're not in a hectically political, well, overtly political crisis.
Yeah.
Most of them are subliminal and we've learned to live with them.
Mm.
But I think we are not making life and death choices every day. You're not thinking, let me leave a hand grenade underneath my girlfriend's pillow because we don't know who's going to come shake the house at the end of the night, you know? Mm. We don't have those kind of things where we can at least move two steps further to self-actualizing in this lifetime so that our kids know nothing but that, you know, how to follow your passion from 2 years old is your chat with the universe.
And what do you say there? We live for the weekend.
So this
Something
is the...
like that, right?
Yeah, this is the thing that breaks my heart that like... Not when our parents couldn't be what they wanted to be. If my dad wanted to be a musician, he couldn't. He has to think about practical ways of surviving. I can't become a musician because I'm making practical decisions.
Mm.
You know? So I think the onus is on us to realize that we are in an easier space, even though they are difficult in other times. I guess there's always balance, but let's try and make... And also, if you're in a position to help people make better decisions about working towards... work that's meaningful, that's attached to their life, like to their gift and to their purpose here, you know, not just to survive. Young people are owed better, don't you think?
I totally agree. And I love the type of writing that you do. Your pen game does go a bit deep at some point. I mean, where does your consciousness come from?
My consciousness, I think it's an awareness that it's shifting a lot, you know, that there are days where I'm just living from a carnal place and my calendar's stressing me and I'm like, in my body, you know, and I'm worried about making meetings on time. And there's a time where I can shift to a more 4D consciousness or a four-dimensional way of understanding that I'm spirit and I'm guided and no conversation's a mistake, to shifting to another sphere of consciousness where it's so obvious how connected we are and all you want to do is like fix the things that don't make you move with unconditional love. That's all you're worried about. There are times where you don't want to eat because you're stuck in a book. That's taking you to a dimension where you want to grow to the next level. So I just stay true to those shifts. I trust them. If this week maybe I need to feel more practical, it's maybe because I need to be there more for my kids.
Yeah.
You know, just to get stuff logistically done. It doesn't mean that I can't float away in my Chakrahan balloon and go and connect with myself and bring myself back, you know? It's so I'm learning the flexibility of it and how nimble the spirit is and how nimble the heart is, you know, if you kind of just tune into where you need to be right now. You know,
and I guess your music sort of sometimes takes you there. Yeah. When a thought comes about a song, you grab your pad, which you always have, and you go and jot down, you know, a couple of words, or you take your phone and you record whatever is coming. That's part and parcel of it, isn't it?
Definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah. I just try to follow those nudges.
Because
I think the signs are there, almost like, you know, there's a bit of guidance for each hour, for each 30 minutes. As long as you're willing to listen, there's a bit of guidance.
Right. You know. Zanelisa, the album. Yeah. I mean, I told you, it was just something special, I think. And this was your introduction, you know, to a degree, to many ears.
Definitely, yeah.
Tell us about that process.
I mean, a very humble process of understanding that it's a snapshot in time and I need to share this song, whether it's finished, shaky, you know, perfect. Mm. It was just like, okay, let's assemble for the photograph. Let me assemble the right musicians. I meet Nkulumakatina, I play in the music. I'm like, my band knows that I've taught them.
Mm.
Can you co-produce with me to just make sure that it lands the best way possible?
Sure.
And he was just like, yeah, okay.
Let's do it.
I'm coming with.
Tavaza Nkulumakatina.
And so I've had a friend and a sounding board and a brother and a bandmate and a co-producer, you know, since that day, I've had in and out of different seasons where I'm making different things, but he's always a phone call away or 2 a.m. We're trying to go, babes, with 2 a.m. emails.
Babes
with 2 a.m. I'm like, load shedding. So he's a recipient of that club, my 2 a.m. musings about life, you know, when I allow myself to float a little bit. So,
Now, you know, the songs on that particular album, you know, were they songs that you'd written sporadically as you grow, or it was intentional to say, I'm doing this project, I'm penning down music, I'm collaborating, and this process will unfold in such a manner?
So I'd had a bit of a trial run. 2013, I released an EP that I recorded in a friend's boat studio. It's an Afrikaans guy called Gobus van Wyk. Beautiful, just a beautiful, intuitive, quiet person. He was an engineer who had this incredible deep love for music. I'd see him at all the little live shows. There was no scene. We had to create a scene. There was always a poetry scene. I don't know if you know Transkei Republic, Kotsi. You know that whole vibe. The scene that was really growing was the poetry scene. This poetry scene started really making space for music, and the music was always in the people.
Yeah.
But it's like, it just became more of a something that would always happen. But the poetry circles were the most diligent, you know. And I remember I had just come back from Rhodes University and Leeds University, where I had been studying fine art.
Okay.
How I got there is another story. Because the last I told you is that I went to go study law, right?
Yeah, yes, yes.
Okay.
And then find out Rhodes.
Yeah, I know. So let me start there. I just come back as a student.
Yeah.
I wanted to be a musician, but I was afraid to put my parents in a space where they would stress about my well-being because I'm not ready to support myself in Johannesburg. I wasn't ready to make the big move. So me being part of the scene was also learning how to organize. It was a way to... You know, we all saw all the musicians that everybody knows, like Oslik Angel or the MX or Zahara, everybody. She's not, you know, definitely all moving around the same space. Sure. Angel.
Mm. Sure.
I'm trying to think. There's so many more that went through to become national and household names. Yes. But that's what we're catching a lot of people as Alt Black, but also supporting them from home until they're ready to, because they've been playing the festivals and now they're getting a better rates, and then we're like, okay, let's help you move, you know? So that's what Alt Black does, that kind of like weird, unseen, you don't even know if you need it until you're in that situation type of work, which unfortunately for me, I've known it because I've walked the path of being an independent artist since that 2013 EP.
Right.
So 2013, it was the EP. I did like a 4-track thing just in that my friend's studio boat, mostly guitar voice and a little bit of session musicians. There was a friend of mine that I was studying with in Grahamstown who also drove down. He was in a band with me that we had started there with music students. So he came and did the drums. So a lot of people just being really generous.
Pitched in.
I got a wonderful grant from the IDC. I did a corporate for them. They pulled me aside and they were like, what's your story? And I'm like, I want to do an EP. And they gave me $100,000. So I was able to pay everyone. book a launch at the Guild Theatre, and that was my first little push into the sea.
Wonderful.
And my first little newspaper article where they were like, we think she can sing, you know?
Oh, wonderful.
And yeah.
And that was what, 2012?
2013. 2013. Yeah. So that kind of, I wanted to put something out there. I wanted something to sell that these gigs we were organizing. You know, I saw myself in Ndembe Plandi selling the CD from the boot. I knew that I was going to be learning that part of the journey.
Yeah.
You know, process. Really interfacing with my audience and my potential audience. Yes. I was walking around a beachfront.
Wow.
And saying, check it out.
Check it out.
Yo, hey, are you having a good bride? Listen, I have this EP. It's about that beach right there. I wrote it on that beach over there. and sometimes I get to tell my story and someone's like, no, I want to sing. Mm. And it's this beautiful real life interface with the people that ended up being my family. They call themselves my day ones because they remember buying those EPs for me.
And they're still physically, there with you now.
Physically, yeah. You know, and nobody, I never put it for to honor them. And the fact that, because La Malia said, I designed up in the print, you know. The print, I got a beautiful quote, and this is the beginning of me also learning supplier language, understanding how to deal with people that are part of the whole value chain.
It was a good process.
That's invisible, a great learning curve. And I started my own little label called One Shishide Artistry to house all of that in and to, you know, pay people well and to figure out a business model that cared about my community.
Is that still active?
Yeah.
The label.
Yeah. It is.
And
I think those are the last days of the physical. Physical offering, like a CD.
Yeah, just the tail end, yeah.
That was just the last days. I remember, I mean, 2013 or so, digital era just kicked in.
Sure.
Because I remember this is when Zahara just came out.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I think she was on her second album or so.
Mm.
2013, that's when I was also just leaving the music.
Okay.
So I remember that's when the physical sales were sort of dying out.
Sure.
And the industry was evolving into the digital era.
Yeah.
Now, some of the titles, Msaki, let's talk. We're still talking the EP. What titles did you have there? Songs?
The EP was called Nali Temba.
Nali Temba, yes.
Nali Temba.
Yes.
The title song was Nali Temba. It had Liwa Lentliziyo. It had Crimson Love.
Crimson Love.
Oh. And it had, I can't remember. I think it had like an a cappella reprise called Deep in the Well. Deep in the Well.
Right.
So that was the EP.
And of course, I mean, we were just, you know, talking about your song.
Oh, Nymphama Ziyabona.
Yes. Nymphama Ziyabona.
Yeah.
That song, man. It is something else. But I think what leads up to, you know, the beauty of your songs is that growing up, you were able to just escape into reading. And you're talking about going down, you know, a rabbit hole when you're stuck in a book. And I think that's where now you kind of, you know, get your writing skills. You know, as Boo was putting it, your writing game is just on another level. You know, and I guess that's where you find the words or the right expressions or sentences or whatever you call it to actually piece together, you know, something. A word or a verse that's meaningful to me who's listening, right? Because you are able to visually picture it in some way that possibly I can't see it, right?
Yeah, I think we all have the ability to do that.
Yeah, I know. No, and it's just we don't all have it.
Levels of surrender to that.
Right.
You know, it's almost like we all have
the calling.
Yeah.
I'm saying it's a calling.
Like, no, that inherent gift to be creatively true to an idea, you know? So I think, and also bold in expressing it, but I think what makes it difficult is that we are at different levels of surrendering to the idea or to the end product. So if you're like a high resistance person, you're only going to use 20% of your creativity. Doesn't mean that the 80% is not there, but you're living a life of high resistance. You're like, whatever has happened, whether it's been, you know, systematic brainwashing or school or family problem, whatever's making you feel like I must live a risk-free, expressionless life. That's the, you know. So I'm just saying that, like, I don't think that we creatives or me as a songwriter or as Msaki has got a talent that we don't have access to songe, a way that we all mirror the creator. Surely we're all creative beings.
Right.
By default, before si chunwe lilizwe, you know. I think maybe whatever's happened to me in my past or my life or my childhood has given me more levels of surrender. I have a song called No Resistance. You know, I'm praying that into my life. I meditate that. But hey, I'm on, you know, just go with the flow because I fought for this purpose-led life, right?
And here it is now.
So I'm inside it.
Yes.
I'm not swimming upstream.
It's
I'm
just with you now.
I'm just, so my problem slept different. It's a rock in the way, on the way to the to the sea. I'm not going up stream where the water is getting thin and altitude is messed up. I'm not going uphill. Mm. I'm in the thing that I'm here to do, you know.
Hamba no more. Umkulolo says, let's align with nature.
With nature.
So
yeah, nature provides.
So the way she explains it, I'm just flowing with the
thinking,
water.
You're thinking that, right?
Those obstacles could be like those rocks, Nyana, but I'm flowing with the flow.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not going upstream against, against the flow.
Yeah.
So now there comes a point where the houseboys start knocking at your door, realizing the beautiful voice, realizing your musicality. Must have been a shock, I guess.
So the first one wasn't a shock because Umobi.
Yeah.
I knew him from high school.
Moby Dixon. Moby
Dixon.
Oh, Marvin love Color Spin.
Exactly.
Yes.
Marvin Dooley dragged me kicking and screaming to the studio. I had just finished a show with the Little Us Theatre in this, like, trying to organize my life as a musician, show my parents, being a musician won't kill me, I swear, and I can feed myself.
Yeah.
And then, you know, allow them to let me go as I, you know, chase my dream. But he found me in that phase where I was organizing, finding band members, teaching people my music, you know, trying to get a sense of community, but also be known by people in this music community that I exist, you know?
Yes.
So Umobi came to one of my shows. And he's like, "Hi, well, we thought you were a hockey player. Come over from my school." And it was like a brother-sister school.
So he's
like,
see.
I just remember he was a hockey player and a tennis player. This is confusing. And I'm just like, oh, come on, man, Moby, come to my show. He's like, Divangawe? Like, oh my gosh, horrible. Horrible. But that's my childhood, you know?
Oh, wonderful.
Completely obsessed with sport and absorbed by the world of competitive athletics. I was really, you know, my family all played sport. My sub-sibling, Usioli Lusaseni, was number one, like, squash player in the country for her age group, and 16 and 17 and 18. My brother played rugby, ended up playing for Sharks, Lions, and now he's a coach at Sharks.
Wow.
And so if I decided to be a sports person,
you could have been,
I could have been, yeah.
Yeah.
But in varsity, the varsity, while they're on sports scholarships, I got taken by the musicians.
The music. Yeah. Springtide with the Revolution.
Yeah, they called
I think it's
me,
one of those underrated house, banging house songs.
Thank you.
The Twins.
Yeah, their production for me, I mean, I was a fan. I think I bought their, I had the all 10 of their CDs between my brother and I.
Yeah.
My brother's 2 years younger than me. And he was also like a secret producer, really into music, played piano at high school. They called him Black Hoven. and we used to collect these Revolution albums. And I'll never forget the day I heard Bavenda.
Yeah.
Oh. And I'll never forget the day I heard Who
wasn't vocals like, there?
Maduva.
Maduva.
Yeah. Maduva. I'm saying it in close. Light of my life. What a beautiful song.
You caused me to
smile.
Ooh.
Never thought I could be loved.
Yeah.
By someone like you. And then she got us there. You are the one I'd like to spend my life with. And then December, we're like, you know, in the car, just like,
yeah.
Have we ever known this kind of love? But the Revolution Brothers changed my life. And as, you know, I was saying to you just now when we were chatting, they've stayed in my life as a support system, as a counsel, as a cheerleader. You know,
beautiful.
As a crisis control, I'm like, my speakers have blown, and they're like, okay,
we got
down.
You, we got you,
you know. And it's just so nice to have those big brothers and
looking after you,
just looking after you because they're like, they've seen it all, man. They're like, yo, if you meet a lawyer like this in a lift, don't say anything.
Just be mute. Fetch your life.
That was something else. I think you really put pen to paper there. On Fetch Your Life. She put pen to paper there. I mean,
you must listen to the I don't want to call it a cappella version. Is it reprise or something?
No, version? So I just that's just the live version. That's me and what I taught my band. for our own, you know, yeah, to be able to perform it without. I don't, this is the thing, guys, I can't even remember the moment of really writing these songs because I think they're caught first. I just had to, my aerial must have been up at that time. And okay, it's a message that isn't divorced from the things that I care about.
Right.
So the song would find me, you know what I mean?
Mm.
Wherever it's from. Because I worry about young people and I worry about the things we spoke about.
And you have children.
Will we make it better for our kids to be able to really chase their dreams and make sure that they're not wasting what they are given in this time, you know, in this life. So, and how do they share love? How do we, because I think that's what our gifts are leading us to, isn't it? Yeah. That like, how do you share love in the purest way? And maybe the way that gives you joy too.
Yes.
So that you can do it with an open heart, even if you understand your value, you know, but you're exuding from the abundance of you know, God of love, of the universe, wanting to see something beautiful, you know? Because I think life is meant to be beautiful.
Mm. Yeah, it is. Yeah. It actually is. I think in most cases, we just complicate it, you know, for ourselves, where a lot of things within this maze of life, you know, just distract us from that one vision. And the utmost thing, I think, right at the top is love. Ubuntu betu, which we have. But then, you know, we have to deal with so much that we really forget about those true elements of impilo, yabantu, bagwantu, you know, to a degree. But yeah, I mean, that's life.
Ubomi abumanga. Ubomi abumanga, ne?
Abumanga.
I like when she writes music that encourages or inspires an ordinary dude somewhere in some corner of this country, somewhere, somebody who's got a dream, somebody who probably thinks they might never make it in life, but just you listen to that ubomi abumanga and you just listen to the lyrics. The pen game, bro. She's not playing. She's
not so much. Yeah.
Moving the youth.
It's sickening through sometimes, your writing. You know? It's sickening your pen game.
It's
sickening. And then we're talking about the go movement as well. I mean, it came knocking on your way. Mm. Were you not afraid that you'd get detached from your essence as a musician and whatever, you know, path you had carved in your head, you know, on how you want to present your movement? Because now you've got this ebb and flow of, you know, other genres coming in. And it's mostly requests. People requesting, you know, be it, you know, your lyrical content or your voice that they love so much. So there must have been some sort of, you know, pull from you all.
Because people were more concerned about it than I was like, hey man, what happens when I get to a studio and someone plays a beat? I'm listening to the chord shape and I decide if it suits my voice.
Right.
You know, it's not really like, it's just a box, you know, it's just a genre. It's a way to classify something. It's an easy way to file creative ideas. But at the same time, it's not going to restrict me from being moved by like, you know, a chord progression that I don't know. I just want to, if I can hear the essence or a shape,
then you can
or something that gives me a sense of the emotion and me and that person have got something to say together, if I keep quiet for long enough, I'm going to catch a song.
Yeah.
Because the song is always above us, you know?
Yeah.
So I don't know. I don't think the genre conversation is one that I'm really interested in very deeply.
Yes.
I get it, but I didn't see my essence diluted. I felt like, what is different about these two chords than when I sit in my room, you know? Is it the presentation? Is it, maybe it's just reaching spaces that need to go, that need whatever it is that we're trying to say together.
Correct.
You know, so I feel like in every song, whether it's a house song, whether it's an Amapiano song, there's always been enough room made for me to come and defigure as Asanda with my heart, with the things that I care about, being the ability to catch the song in my way, do with it what I can to make it its best thing and send it out the way that it needs to go out in that moment and trust that moment, you know? I didn't feel like it was taking away from my essence at all. In fact, I can sing all of my house songs as a candlelight guitar, you know?
I can do them all. And it's
I can
warm.
Do them all. They belong.
Do them all.
It's just chord progression. It's just the shape.
It's not rocket science, really.
It's just a shape underneath an idea. Mm. And the idea gives it life. You know,
play. Don't mind us. You can play. You don't mind.
I don't know
us.
What to play.
No,
play something from Zanelli's or something.
No,
I don't
so
know.
I want to prove this point that I own every house song or my piano song that I've ever been part of wholeheartedly because I took in the shape that either the producer or we came up with together.
Right.
And I hold it in my heart. And so the song lives with me. It doesn't live in a genre, you know? Mm. So this is Fetch Your Life. Your back sways in parabola motions, right on time with the latest club incantation. We live for the weekend, working up the courage, oh, and we pray away, pray away, pray away the pain of not being in alignment with our dreams. Fetch your life, go on, be alive. Ain't nobody living out here, be someone who's living out here. Fetch your life, go on, be alive. Ain't nobody living out here, be someone who's living out here. Fetch your life, go on, be alive. Ain't nobody living out here, be someone who's living out here. Fetch your life, go on, be alive. Ain't nobody living out here, be someone who's living out here.
Fetch your life.
Yeah. Get on more, yeah, move.
So effortless, right?
Effortless.
That's what happens with these geniuses. It's like,
effortless.
They make it look easy.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. You've since, obviously, we're talking about your relationship with other genres, and you know, you've just been specific to us on that. You know, for you, you just find it. You know, with just these chord progressions, and you're able to slip in into it, and make whatever is sort of needed within the genre, but the music remains your own. Talking albums. And Zanelisa, you know, it's been a couple of years since you released that.
2016.
Yeah. What can we look forward to in terms of what's coming up? Are you going back to that as Msaki, or have you?
Oh my goodness, please don't tell me that you missed my double album.
Which one?
I released it last year.
Dropped the double album during
Platinumb
COVID.
Heart.
Ooh, yeah.
I think it was just after the lockdown.
A lot of collaborations in there though, yeah?
Yeah, and it's essentially me saying that there's two sides of me. I had felt the duality that you're speaking of.
Sure.
And the one album was called Platinumb Heart Beating, and it had almost all the collaborations I've had from like Black Coffee,
yes.
You know, Sanele. Everyone was there. And new friends that I'd made, a couple. Cairo, that's the one that's gone.
Oh, Cairo's amazing.
Yeah, he's amazing.
Cairo is the next one internationally.
Yeah. Two songs with Black Motion. Anyone that had ever invited me to their space,
right.
I invited them back.
You invited them back.
Tried something with Moby, it didn't work for the album. We're still working. We always have that. Like, I missed his last album and he missed. But the thing is, the willingness to still try and be like, what do we have in this world between us, you know?
Yeah. Correct.
And he's essentially the guy that broke me. We had a number one song while we were in the Eastern Cape, Love Color Spin.
Yeah.
And then it was also an underground, like people knew it in the clubs.
They knew it in the clubs,
which is how I can still play it now. I still play it on my sets. You know, so Moby's the guy.
So do you appreciate that you didn't resist, you know, when the house boys came knocking?
No, I mean, there's a level of resistance that sometimes happens. Like Fetch Your Life, KB sent me that beat 2 years ago. But I was like, I'm about to have my daughter. I don't have anything to say on it. Maybe it's not for me right now, you know? And again, like when he hit me up, he's like, I'm about to release another album. I was like, let me listen to that beat you sent me.
Right.
And then the song just dropped on my lap, you know?
It came.
So sometimes it's just a timing thing. And it wasn't really like I would listen to my spirit. I would also think about the fact that you make a song with someone, you have a child, and can this person co-parent this child well? and okay. and if, And sometimes I'd look and I'd be like, "What's on? Sogoli salo? And I wouldn't. Yeah. Because now we are in communication. You have a direct line to me. And we've created one spiritually too. Do I want to deal with this person?
Right. You know? Yeah. And at times we are told about umoya uvum.
Uvum umoya. Inga fi English strong student session when I see no be MacGyver to get to it. Still unga fiki. So I was like, chaps, I can't force it. Sorry, I'm out. I'm going to bed.
And then you can't force music. You know?
Yeah.
Now, just talking to where you know your music sort of you know takes you. I'm sure you enjoy the stage more than anything.
Oh my goodness, do I have stories for you?
You know what I mean?
No.
I'm sure you enjoy that platform, that interaction with the people, and that's why we know.
You're hearing me. I can't do this.
And you go, what never. Stories Did you
I do not like the stage.
You don't?
No. Not at all.
Why not though?
Not at all. Not even in the slightest. I think I'm...
You seem so comfortable.
I think I am 65% songwriter. I catch a lot of songs and not all of them are meant to be performed by me. The 10% that's meant to be performed by me, I know.
Okay.
That, okay, this one is maybe for my... Otherwise, I have to find the owners of these songs. I'm a songwriter first, right?
So have you written for a whole lot of other people?
Oh, yeah. That's what I do.
Okay.
So also, my personality doesn't allow me to be around lots of people with a lot of energy and a lot of... Like, I can't do it for long. So sure. I don't think I'm a natural performer. I've learned my way around the stage. I've even learned what to do with my hands when I don't have a guitar. It was very awkward at first. But
what
it's
do you do?
Better.
You fiddle with your hands. What do you
my
do?
My pocket. I look like a gangster. I'm like, please, you don't want people to feel like they're in danger, you know? But no, I was trying to say to you that, like, my understanding of my life as a songwriter is making my stage reluctance make sense. And I think there's nothing that I need to do, you know, to fix that right now. It's just that I'm my heart is more for songwriting and I'm a reluctant performer because I know that whether it's for my own project, my own story, my own understanding of locating myself geographically, you know, emotionally, that photograph I spoke about, but just an album and sometimes just a snapshot.
Just
you know?
A snapshot.
So it's like, hey, it's been a couple of years. Kopi nutatanyi, state of the heart address, photo, and then move on, you know? Sometimes I can't, I was with my band to do that, and I know when it's my turn to.
But surely, you know, you've gotten over that because, I mean, you've graced a lot of stages since you began and whatever it is, you know, that you're putting forth, you know, you've been able to go over the hill. So to speak.
Yeah, no, it's a Makayandini pep talk in the locker room every day when I have to do that.
Really?
Nothing prepares me for stage.
Any ritual that you do?
Until so many.
So many?
I am doing babes with rituals.
Babes got 2 a.m.
Always.
Babes with rituals. Hey, babes, babes.
Babes with everything. Babes with everything.
Yeah.
I have a stick of Palo Santo because I'm respiratory. When you're nervous, your breathing goes out.
Yeah,
you know?
Yes.
So anything that's encouraged me to take deep breaths, right? And I realized that, okay, incense doesn't work for me. It actually doesn't actually do much. But Palo Santo, I can take it in. I mean, I try to be as quiet as possible. I try to move away from people. It's difficult sometimes. In these festivals, you're thrust backstage, which are your aunts, and you just, you know, have that moment to go into your own inner world. But like, sometimes spatially, it doesn't allow, you know? I need time. I need time to warm my voice up. I think... It's only fair to start with my tool slightly chiseled, you know?
Yeah.
So I fight for that time. Even if I have to go back to the car, if I have to kick someone out of a locker room, if I have to get my manager to complain, I fight.
You fight for that.
For that time to warm up.
It's important, I think. Yeah.
It's respectful to my... And like, this is the thing that I think about Oprah Hugh. There was just so much discipline in the musicianship and putting in the hours, you know? In the secret space. So that's also, I think, why... The stage as a secondary home for me, one that I've learned to navigate slowly until I am, it's because like I've always believed that songs that you play more in the secret space will bless you and others because you've kind of rehearsed you've rehearsed your creative well, but you've also rehearsed the where they come from. They've had a chance to go past those. If you think about your heart or your brain or whatever,
right.
they've had a chance to go all the way around all the way around the map,
right?
And maybe once or twice, and so by the time you're sending that out, it's, you know, ipuma lighter.
It's authentic. It's, yeah. It's real.
If it's a song on healing, now I have the permission to give it away. Because nansi ndiphila, you know, but in pilisile now, you know. So I think that's why the stage is just the one of those last stops on the value chain. Ingoma ifikele enhleni ndedwe Romina, you know.
Ulila mhlambe about something.
And mhlambe zitya and Jesus ngalapho. But it's been a bad day and the dishes can feel it. And the song comes. To comfort you, you don't even have an idea. Mama, you quote a song. You don't understand. Like, Fama Zebon, I was like, what poetry nonsense? What am I saying? Apo Zeakonim Fama Zebon. Ngambezela nawe. I don't understand sometimes the whole picture of it. And the song unfolds. Year one in my life of having it. Year two, year three. So sometimes, funeke ndicule before nditi, okay, ndiyayithumela kuPaul ngoku khe ndidlale in compilers. We had a big chart in the Eastern Cape.
Yeah.
All the radio stations, the email addresses, yeah. And the station. It was like the compilers and the station managers.
Yeah, yeah.
And you could call and say, "You're blind. You're blind. You could just still send music.
Yeah.
You know.
That's what it's all about. It's beautiful though. And then Alt Black. Which you had already explained. It's sort of a, you know, a hub to cushion, you know, musicians. But I feel it's an important hub or facility, you know, to exist. How did the thought process of that, you know, come through? And what has, you know, its success been as, I don't know, what do you call it? It's not a label, right?
No. It's a collective. It's a community.
Yes.
It's also ever widening because the membership agreement is not that you have to release a record or that anything that, you know, is yours is now ours.
Iki contract ndiya sign up.
Contract to corner.
Okay.
If you want to release an album through us and our partners Platoon.
Okay.
One of the things that we do is mostly just like the, you know, widening people's audiences. And by that we curate events where the sound quality is good and anybody that saw you at Fête de la Musique, if you've invited them here, you sound better.
You sound better.
You've had the means to pay a bigger band. You're expanding. You're kind of getting to your dream performance. So those kind of things, those are conversations away. And the reason why I have a heart for them is because I remember the struggles when I was ready to, I need a new band. I need more in my band. But I can't afford to hire a bassist and a percussionist and a violin. Like I need to make, you know,
yeah.
Those creative choices where your spirit is telling you you need to move. If the community around you at least is saying,
All of those things
in. Yeah, so small things that I learned through experience. I'm like, oh, I'm ready to take a show to the National Arts Festival. How expensive is it to take a show to the National Arts Festival?
Yeah.
It's so expensive. Yeah. Do I have 70K lying around?
We are Makanda.
When I'm organizing, shows in the community, we're getting our 5 rands and 10 rands at Telamanca if our friends even pay. Because mostly those are musicians and artists themselves. In those sessions. So nobody's really making money off the door. You're just keeping each other alive creatively. And that's invaluable as well.
So this is a lifetime movement or community, shall we say, this Alt Black. And it will be something I foresee that will surpass even your legacy.
I really hope so. And that's why I'm very heavy on delegating and lots of training and taking people on to show them how to support this community of alternative musicians, live musicians, cultural workers, you know, people that have got this gift, but because they are not necessarily in the mainstream and expressing a certain way, they're not getting the right support and the right attention and the right means to make a living for themselves. But these are the musicians that will tour, or Malcolm Gianni will tour, will go to, you know what I mean? We'll go to North Sea Jazz Festival as like one of the few South African acts that have managed to do that. Zoe Modiga. You know?
I heard she was just so splendid at the North Sea Jazz. You know, she just blew everyone away.
So a musician, the caliber of Zoe Modiga should be able to say to any government institution, to any NPO that understands art, the same way that, you know, Art Kajiswayo in Germany, whatever, you don't have to be a great musician.
Yes.
If you are just practicing, there will always be a residency to fund you. There'll always be a Prince Klaus fund to give you money when you want to record an album. That's the kind of support that we want to provide to this industry and to this sub-industry, which is actually the backbone. It's the same people that Utandis was talking about.
Sure.
You know.
Yeah, your relationship with her, Sistandiso?
She's amazing.
How did you guys meet?
Sistandiso, I met her in Usisi, Fly. So yes,
Fly.
Fly. You know, she's been friends with people we've only read about in autobiographies, like as peers at some point, you know, as much as, because at the festival, the slot is Thandiswa Mazwai, and then it's Peter Gabriel, and then it's not Thandiswa Mazwai Jr. or Vubani. She's there holding her own as a peer of Peter Gabriel and Mamriya Mageba or whoever she was with there, you know. So she is Usisi Kum, definitely, creatively, spiritually, communitily.
Communitily.
And somehow she just took a liking to me. I was doing a show with the Muffins. She was singing with the Blackjacks. This was years ago. It was when I started my few trips, Kengogo, making those little adventure trips to go see what's happening in Joburg because I felt a pull to the artistic community here. So yeah, I did a show at an old venue called Imonti on Bree. Crazy.
Imonti on Bree.
A long time ago.
Uh-huh.
Imonti on Bree.
Yeah.
First trip into Joburg. Played a sort of show. I think I had like an electric guitar. I had some weird mohawk thing. Uh-huh. And she just took a liking to me. She's like, you're going to be my friend. And I was like, give me back my bag. Because she took my bag from my friend. So I was like, give me back my bag. Who are you?
Yeah.
And then I was like, oh, time's almost right. I was like, okay, let me not be rude. And I'd just flown in from Iceland and I still have like sand pocket, like I had sand in my jean pockets.
Yeah.
And I was such like a wild creature.
Sure.
Just like always at the
sea. With pants you'd worn on the beach
at some point. At some point, before the flight. So I knew of her and then every time sometimes she'd be at Coffee Bay playing with Ondo Mitongo and I would spend a lot of time there learning some finger picking yempakanga, spending time man. Just then this tall, I just was like going through my own like spiritual chats, you know? And so I knew that she'd frequent it and every time, sometimes I'd run into her, we'd talk, then I'd let her know when I was in Joburg and I started frequenting Joburg a little more, you know, after the next gig was at the African Freedom Station. And then from there, I started getting booked.
Beautiful space, yeah.
You know, and then so my visits to Joburg started becoming a bit longer because there was more to do. And then I'd go home and regroup and that's how I started.
Such a pity that venue closed. I mean, Steve just did wonders there.
Yeah.
And a small, compact space, but I mean, there was so much going on, art, poetry, music. And it was just this space that just gave, you know? You know, Malcolm Gianni, they went through that. And then Malcolm disappeared. And you're speaking of Malcolm Gianni. Ubuyilu Malcolm. And ubuye ngamandla, man.
Ubuye ngamandla.
You know?
Yeah.
I think before I let you go from Sister Nisha's question, should we expect a collaboration between the two of you?
We have such a, like a, I'd call it a very, our relationship is based on a lot of ease. I'm like the least amount of stress for her. It's always about what she needs to do in the moment. And I think if the space allows and we feel like the timing is right, we have access to each other. But I don't think the initial pressure is to, now that we know that we're friends and we like each other, let's do a song. I think it's just to show up for where a person is at that time in the expression, you know? So we actually, we became friends also because we found, one of her really good friends, Minisutando Bongela, is like a really good friend of mine, older sister kind of person as well. And we just started bumping into each other around people that we liked and were choosing. So we saw that we kind of belong to a similar soul family, you know, to some extent with some deviations. Because we're like, I'm like, I don't want to talk to those people. They talk too much. And I'm nervous, you know. And so, I don't know, like it became clear that, okay, we do share. There is a meeting spot in terms of our social our social community. And then when I really got to know her, we were in New York for about a week or two with Somi. And I got to spend a lot of time with her even before. And then I saw her again. I just kept visiting her in New York when she was doing her spells. I was there that time she was recording with Michelle, just kind of just there for emotional support. Even though the studio was there, I knew that what I needed to be there was the person who's like, yo, do you guys need cheese sandwiches? She's nervous. Let me help her finish writing.
And that was
part.
Enough for you at that
That's
stage.
That's what, you know,
yeah.
I was doing my own thing. And we just tried to, I just tried to sync with her so that I could be there when she needed someone. Because you're also alone with a band and it's work and there might not be a place where you can go and collapse, you know. And you're not in a country that you can call home as much as, you know.
It's true.
So,
It's true.
I think that's when we became friends. So
They always say don't take advantage of people's kindness, but I'm going to ask you for another song.
I would gladly
Such is the request. Farmers Airborne.
She's not going to say no.
Okay.
Farmers Airborne.
Just for our audience, you know.
Definitely.
Please.
Infamas yabona, infamas yabona, famas yabona, infamas yabona, famas yabona, infamas yabona, famas yabona, fama aposia kona, infamas yabona, nambezelana, sutibana kona. Dagu bonu li langa simam lezweni between itanu yako no tando lwake suli nyembezi ukubu tikesha aposya kona akotwa mangeba dagu bonu pila haka temfazweni between itanu yako no tando lwake. Saddle up my friend, let's go to the borders. Oh, that's here or now, or uncharted waters. I'm the one who knows how beautiful you are. I hear what they say, but I've loved you from the start. Ooh, na, sandela wena. Ooh, na, sandela wena. Ooh, na, sandela wena.
Yeah. Infamous Yabon. It's a beautiful song, right? It just, you know.
Goosebumps, bro. I mean,
it just touches like, me.
And then look at her. Look at her. She's just chilled.
Yeah.
look at her.
I mean, it hurts.
Thank you. Okay.
Like, oh, but Paul, you know, it's just a song.
I quote that song after I learned that my grandfather was a composer.
Mm.
In fact, I think I found out the depth of his gift the day after. Because I was like, I mean, at that time, I didn't even understand angel numbers. I was like, I remember because I had one of those little Samsung. No, it was a... Ericsson.
Ericsson.
Yeah. But it had a voice recorder.
Oh, I see.
So I grabbed it. 3:33, I remember the voice note hit. And I recorded just Infamous Yabona, Infamous Yabona. Just that stack. Infamous Yabona, Infamous Yabona, Fama. There's four part harmony. And I'm like, I don't write like this sometimes. I don't just get the whole stack.
Wow.
You know, as a I will build harmonies when recording, but I don't usually hear music like this. So I was like, this is interesting. And I colors and I recorders on layers and the pen and a lot. So I'm not that the kitchen. Like I bo. And then the coffee king go manje, fig and jet gets a stimuli.
Yeah, yeah.
And he was like, you know, your grandfather was a stimuli composer. And then he went into this whole like more specific about what he actually did.
Yes.
The song and that song and the song. So I take it as a gift from him because I don't think I would have, you know. I wouldn't have come up with that. But it's like I caught something that I think is a gift and I've always felt close to my grandfather, even though I never met him. But I've met his music.
Mm.
I've met his sense of humor. I've met his melodic sensibility. I've met his playfulness. He had a song called No Meva that I also went and worked out for this Platinumb Heart album.
Sure.
And it's just like this... It sounds like Flight of the Bumblebee is close.
Yeah. You know,
he does the song where he's talking about Unomeva that won't leave. You get the feeling of Unomeva who's like not giving you a chance to rest. So he's like,
Wow.
Kudala ndithule. Nangu nomeva ezula zula ingqondo yam. And then he carries on, but it gets more frantic. And it gets so like, you hear this person is being chased by a damn horse right now.
Wow.
You know? Yeah. And what's something that's always happened, if I go to a place for long enough, if let's say I go to a writing camp for a week,
yeah.
Outside of my room, there'll be two wasps or two bumblebees or, oh, or it's just like two bees or two. Yeah. Other. I'll always see that. When I was at Nyrox, I had these two bumblebees that were forever buzzing around in my space. And then, you know, and I mean, I never met them, but these like little clues, I think, or
yeah, to say, Barco, he's in the space or something, right?
I miss your Nyrox show. Yeah. A lot of people spoke highly of it.
I mean, it's such a beautiful space, Nyrox. Incredible venue. I think that venue, you know, needs to just live more, you know, and open up more, you know, to everybody else. I mean, I've certainly enjoyed a lot of, you know, good music from that. Its serenity is just something beautiful.
Beautiful art.
Yeah,
so I value that song, Mfama Ziyabona. That's what I wanted to say.
You do?
I value it. I mean, it's not like just a song.
Okay, yeah. So I'm not crazy for just loving the song so much.
Oh, so thank you. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, you're always working on something. I mean, you know, constantly in studio. What are we looking forward to in the next couple of months, possibly?
Mm-hmm.
That, you know, you're tuning into collaborations. I don't know.
I've recorded a lot of music with different people, different genres. Some people more in the hip hop. I'm always kind of writing as well for camps and when people are ready to make albums. But it's more of like a support system and a like a clay, you know, you're drawing the moisture out of the person,
right?
Type of thing. So it's important to spend time knowing what is the story, like what do you want to say, where's your headspace. So that takes a bit longer. And unfortunately, like, labels don't want to invest in their artists getting their whole story out sometimes. So it's a bit of a frustrating thing. But I know that I'm built for that kind of work as well.
I think it's because of an era as well. I think labels work with artists that are not moving, but artists that are, you know, that have got some sort of wave happening. I think that's what they catch on to.
For sure. They catch it late.
Yeah.
Sometimes.
Because a lot of them right now, you can see, I think that they've pulled back in terms of investing.
Yes.
Yeah. They wait for you to pop on your own a little bit and then they just come in.
Sure. Yeah.
It's a sad reality though, hey?
Definitely.
It's a sad reality. Yeah.
I'm working on a lot of projects that are away from just me at the moment. I've got like some joint work coming up with Sanal at some point. I've got a trio that it features myself, Dubati, Moloy.
Dubati of Urban Village.
Of Urban Village.
Yes.
And cellist Clement Petit. He worked on Omo Sangara's album. He's incredible. He's working with Blick Bass. He's always between here and Cameroon. An amazing co-writer. So we did a trio under No Forma. And we're going to do volume 1 and 2 of that. Dropping that in February. Yeah, I like that project because it's two lead singers and an instrumentalist. So it's this interesting triangle. And our voices are equal on the project. I'm not, you know, we're both
and
on the narrative.
And this is you, Dubati?
Me and Dubati,
as a vocalist.
As vocalist.
And a cellist, and then,
yeah.
Okay.
So it's minimal. It's interesting. I'm looking forward to it.
It's
going to
be very interesting.
I should send it to you, actually.
Please.
We're mastering it now. We're mastering it. Yeah.
Please send it to me. I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah.
And then in New York, you were just in the back. Drop, or was there something else that you were up to?
Well,
always. It's more like, for me, it's because I've got like a lot of visual stuff to express with my music. New York is great for me in that sense. The right, you know, the right gallery spaces, the right curators. I'm meeting them quite organically.
You feel at home away from home.
I do feel at home. But Neo's there right now. He's about to open a show.
Neo Muyanga. Yeah.
And I'm thinking of actually just trying to go see his show next week because he's also doing a talk. It's also being honored. It's like really great. So my home is actually LA. I love LA. I'm there a lot. This is where my
sun's always good out there.
LA
is like Durban. It's always warm. It's never cold.
But that's where I'm intentionally growing as a songwriter. And so, you know, I'll be spending like a quarter of the year there at least, or half of every quarter. That's because it's difficult to, you know, it's a big town. And like, if you're there for a month and then people are like, we heard you were here, and you're getting invited to sessions, you're already home and you can't really capitalize on the moment. So it's something I have to reckon with, and, you know, been talking to my family about it and what it looks like, and just to at least be able to harvest a little bit of the, because it's promising.
You know? Wanna miss your babies?
No, they don't. My kids now are free agents. They're free range kids.
Oh, they tag along.
They can go wherever we go, wherever beautiful. I go. Because they always, you know, we're life learning, we're unschooling, yes. we're homeschooling. We don't really have a...
Yes.
Yeah, you know, we're not really rooted in terms of a school system. The side yeah. that makes it difficult for them to be with me.
That's the best,
I Let's think, talk a bit know? About that. You homeschool your kids.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So she's unschooled them and she's homeschooling.
Well done.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So out of the system, so yeah. to speak. Yeah.
I posted something on my Facebook a few days ago.
Unkulu talked about it in Zanela.
Oh, did he?
We, you know, really, you know, at times, you know, that whole system can yeah. just... you know, distract, you know, children in the way you want them to sort of move forward.
To progress.
So I'm actually happy, you know, you've taken that route and decision, you know?
Yeah, we just started that way because I think even just the way they came to the world, it was already saying, hey man, I'm going to have a home birth. I'm going to trust. I was lucky I stumbled upon the right information. I found a good midwife. I was given confidence about my birthing abilities. I wasn't talked out of it. And you know what I mean? I think my social circle really saved me because home births were just a normal discussion. Oh, who's got a good doula? Who knows about a great midwife? This is in the Eastern Cape.
And it just happened.
You know?
Yeah.
And so, yeah, gave birth to 3 beautiful children, all at home. Best days of my life. And
congratulations.
Thank you. And I feel like that... trust in the conversation between the mother and the child and not taking that step with a lot of fear that women get. My sister was told by her doctor the first time she came to a consultation without her husband. She's like, oh, are you sure you want to give birth? Like, just quickly schedule a young season and hour. It's so much work. Like, talking a person who's been really deciding that they want to give, you know, they want to give birth naturally. We're getting talked out of it all the time because the guy wants to catch a game of golf at 5. Doesn't want a birth that goes on forever. So the options that women get as opposed to some of the options that I got as like the base knowledge changed what I think is the path of even on the way that we parent because that trust and that conversation means that we're like, hey man, these kids, leave interesting things around them. Make sure that learning is a concept that is just built into the home. There's no building they need to go to learn. Learning is happening all the time.
All the time.
You know?
It's around us. Yeah.
And we also were just like, some of the collaborators that are on offer here, these facilitators, these teachers, they're coming with things. Like, also I'm like, my child is, some white woman is not going to open my child's brain and put knowledge in my child's brain and then close it as if we aren't communicating with the environment, right. as if our interests are not being formed in us when we're young. And I just think the flexibility... to also serve each child's personality well is important.
And it's up to us parents, you know, to sort of guide them through on how we feel we want them, you know, guided really.
But the kids are telling us who they are all the time. My 4-year-old doesn't like waking up before 9.
Yeah.
So creche was hell for her because she was only ready to interact with human beings
after 9.
After she's had, and we realized when she was 3, she started gravitating towards meditation music and realized she needs to center herself first. And then she's ready for the world. And even we'd get this note where she's in the classroom during break again. Is everything okay at home? We're like, yo, was everything okay there? And also ask her. She'll tell you why she's inside the class. Yes. And they'd come back. There's like, she just wants peace and quiet. I'm like, well, then give her that. You know, don't be like, all the other kids are playing outside. This is the lack of space for catering to individual kids. My 7-year-old now doesn't, we don't give her schoolwork before 11. Because she's exactly like me, high adrenaline, wants to climb out windows, wants to punch a few things, wants to run around, use the energy. So the first thing she does is all physical, it's outside.
Yeah. And then she's a model student. Once she's simmered down, you give her the work.
But you can imagine already labeled ADHD, concert still, nuisance, distracting, blah, blah, blah.
And it's like, just human nature.
Let her run around for a bit first, see how that works for you. But school won't have that. As a mechanism to be like, we can't let one child run around there. Miss Haddock, what's going on in your class? Please, can you just keep your children together? So you have to build that for yourself.
Yeah,
you have to build it for yourself.
I said the same thing. I'm like, guys, hey, instead of complaining, let's, you know, that they're not giving good education to our kids. Let's do it ourselves. Yeah. Or maybe just explore both.
Yeah. The flexibility is there, but I think we also need to be co-creating to the system that might not serve us all.
Yeah, you know? But it's beautiful because a lot of people are waking up now. I think also even the COVID-19 lockdowns forced a lot of people to want to go seek knowledge.
Mm.
So it's a beautiful time that we're in, you know?
Mm. I love the fact that some parents realized during lockdown that, man, I shouldn't have been sending my kid to this.
Do you know what I mean? I can do this myself.
But because they got to live it, they had a chance to choose it, you know? So that was pretty cool.
And it made sense, you know? Well, Msaki, wishing you all the best moving forward. You've just always, since I stumbled upon your name and your music, you know, you've just always resonated. And it's so beautiful just seeing your growth, you know, year after year. You said you're not getting used to the award yet, but it's there now. So live with it, because there's going to be more that come along, you know? Yeah?
Grammy's on the way also, by the way.
Hey.
Prophesying it.
Yeah. Injalo.
At least, you know, certificate, at least, just for
now.
That's the other thing. Yeah, Black Coffee, so many inspiring space, like people that are just doing beautiful things.
Beautiful work.
I was with Tuso today, and it's just, we should go hiking in LA, and I'm like, look at you, you're a global superstar.
Yeah, superstar. Yeah. It's beautiful.
And seeing that up close, it changes your own perception
of
how far you can go. So I do want to confess that my dreams are slightly different now, also because of the people around me. I'm meeting more Grammy winners. I'm like, maybe I can hope for one of these.
You belong in that space.
Maybe that's, I can hope. And it's a bizarre to say that out loud.
Yeah.
But I'm like, maybe I should, so that my kid doesn't have to second guess, you know, the floor for her must be my ceiling. And then Khonsa Makhene said the other day, he was like, yeah, but the ceiling, he said, that's but right. The floor is the sky.
The floor is the sky.
I don't even know what made it so funny that day. But I was like,
no, but the floor is the sky.
Yeah, the floor is the sky.
So above as below. You know? So above is below. You gotta love Khonsa. But wishing you all the best.
Thank you.
Please let us know when Neo is in the country. We need to have a chit chat with that genius. It's been a while. This is a genius, you know, that we need to chit chat with. And, you know, he has to give us, you know, I think just the scope on what he's doing now, because he's always searching, you know, within music, within different elements. And I know he did a show some time ago at Soda Studios, and
I organized that show.
Yeah.
But he's like in theater. He's everywhere. He's you know, he's
still scoring artist. As well. Film
we
scoring.
We're co-scoring a movie. We've got a meeting when I come out of this.
Right.
Nice.
Yeah.
Let us know when he's in town. We'd love to chit chat with him. You know.
Congratulations, Siswam.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. It's been a marvel to watch your growth over the years. May you just continue growing. Probably one day, one will be blessed to jump into studio with you. I'd appreciate that moment. You know, it's been an incredible couple of years to be your fan. And thank you for gracing us with your presence.
Thank
it means
you.
A lot.
That means a lot coming from you. Thank you guys for having me.
Magwande.
Magwande. Kukanya. Ladies and gentlemen, House of Sankofa, Msaki, Siyabulele, Thokozani.